like to introduce is Martin Taylor.
Thank you, Kev. Oh, come on. Thank you.
There's always this moment when, no matter how experienced a speaker you are, how used you are to standing in front of a crowd, you're out there talking to a bunch of people who you don't really know, and they don't really know you, and you get this feeling in the pit of your stomach that they call stage fright. But I'm a stage hypnotist, and that means I have a big advantage over most speakers when it comes to stage fright. Because I know that no matter how scared I may be of what you lot could do to me, it's nothing compared with how scared you lot are of what I could do to some of you later on at the end of my talk. First though, I've got to get this lecture out of the way. So that's, thank you, one or two of you on my wavelength. My name is Martin Taylor. I am a stage hypnotist, which I think, can I just start out by saying roughly who am I speaking to here? How many people here consider principally they are into therapy, into a therapeutic hypnotist? Yeah, into that sort of, yeah, about half, okay. How many of you principally stage hypnotists? Want to do it for entertainment? A less enthusiastic, maybe about a third, a quarter of you. So we've got about another third or quarter who don't know. Sorry? Street hypnotist. That counts. You're doing it for entertainment. You're not doing it to change people's lives. That's fair enough. Okay. I'm a stage hypnotist. I am going to be speaking from that point of view. My experience of therapy is nil, so I'm not going to be talking about how I change people's lives. I'm not going to be talking about that kind of thing. I'm going to come on to what I am going to be talking about in a moment. One point of stagecraft I do want to point out. When I work on stage, I use a handheld mic. And I'm lost without it. I have no idea what to do with my hands. I'm going to be taking my glasses on and off. But whenever I'm out here, I always find if I haven't got a mic, my hands wave about. So if I'm standing out here flapping about like this, and you wonder what's happening, what normally happens is this hand will gravitate to this position, and you'll find that I'm talking to you all standing like this. If this happens during my talk, this is not me boasting. This is just where the microphone would live if I was able to work with a handheld one. We've got the thing up here. Right, I could just do my stage act out here, and basically, if you wanted, I could do the standard thing where I get people out on stage and use stage hypnosis techniques to make people look dickheads. Now, if that's what you want, I can do that. But I suspect that may not, I don't know. I've got sort of some nods, some shaking of heads already. We've got people in the front row looking terribly worried already. My God, we're in the front row and he's going to be looking for volunteers. I mean, are there people here who would like me just to get people out and make them look dickheads? If that's what you want, then don't. Yeah, I want to talk about some of the bigger issues. I want to challenge us with some of the things that I think we're getting wrong, some of the ways I think that we're confusing our views on hypnosis, stage hypnosis, therapeutic hypnosis. I want to look at the reasons we're confusing them and just think about some of the ways in which we ought to start asking ourselves fairly important questions and agreeing with each other on some fairly fundamental things. Along the way, I'm going to be talking about how I do my act, Hypnotism Without Hypnosis. At the end, maybe there will be a bit of time where I can demonstrate some of it if that's what you want. But at risk of doing something which is possibly a little more dull, but I do want to do something which is a little more important. So, let me outline roughly the structure of what it is I'm going to be doing. I don't want to deal at all, in the main part, with the technique of what's going on, but I'm going to start out by talking about my personal history and how I got into hypnosis. I want to talk about what I mean by Hypnotism Without Hypnosis, which is the name of my show. That's what I do. I'm going to be, and then I want to talk a little bit about why there is such confusion over hypnosis, why people seem to be talking about different things. Nobody seems to quite agree. Even at a group like this, where we've got so many hypnotists together, you would think that we all knew what hypnosis is, and we don't. You know, already on the talks we've heard this morning, we've had such completely diverse views as to what there is out there. So I want to talk a little bit about why there's such confusion. Then I want to put forward some ideas as to what hypnosis actually is. No answers, but lots of theories, lots of ideas to bang around amongst yourselves. And some of my theories, some of the things that I've come to realize that hypnosis is and is not in the time I've been practicing it, in the 20 years I've been doing it. Then we're going to finish up with how we can sort some of these problems out, some of the things I think we ought to be doing, ways we ought to be discussing hypnosis amongst ourselves. So that essentially is the structure of what I'm going to be talking about. Some personal history, what the problems are, some solutions I've got to them, and then what I think we ought to be doing about them. Then, with a bit of luck, there'll be some questions at the end, and you can ask me whatever you want, either about this or about my stage act that I do. So, I started out by doing a classic hypnosis show. I worked as a magician when I was an undergraduate. I used to go around the halls of residence doing card tricks, essentially, doing the standard stuff you see magicians do. And I got to know that there was another guy going around, a guy by the name of Colin Chave, and he was doing hypnosis. Wow, big, exciting thing. Never heard of this, never seen this. So I contrived to get invited along to see what he was doing. And we got invited along as a double act to people's rooms and things. I would do some magic, and then Colin would get two or three people sitting down, and he would do the classic hypnotist induction. He would get a little pendulum out, swing it in front of their eyes for 20 minutes, half an hour, and yeah, well, that's how we did it in those days. And finally, when he thought that they were deeply under, he would ask them, you know, you now feel that your arm is raising up into the air, and if the arm raised up into the air, that was good. We'd try more stuff. If it wasn't, then he'd go back to doing the swinging of the pendulum for another 20 minutes or so. And he was doing lots of research on what the best kind of pendulum was to use and whether it was better to light it with a blue light or with a green light or whatever. But that's what he did. It was fascinating. It was fun. We got lots of people around. It was a great way to invite friends around, to invite lots of women to sit still and be hypnotized and see what we could do. Great. This is undergraduate life. And then I got talked into trying it. I'm chatting up a girl in her room. And I've done some card tricks, I've done some magic, you know, I've been magic, and I sort of selling of a line, oh, I know all about hypnosis. What? You know about hypnosis? Oh, fantastic, I've always wanted to be hypnotized. Come on, you've got to try this now. And I can't really back down at that stage and say, well, look, you know, I've never actually done it before, let alone hypnotized anybody. And so we had to give this a go. And I, even in those days, thought I should be responsible about this and get some witnesses in. So I got my friend Charles from next door. And Charles and I sat down and watched while I did this thing with Melanie, with what I've seen Colin do before with the pendulum. And we swung this thing in front of her eyes for 20 minutes. And eventually I thought that she was under. And I said, OK, now when I snap my fingers, your arm will rise up to your face. Arm rises to face. I found, oh gosh, this is working. We try some post-hypnotic suggestions. When you open your eyes, you'll take your shoe off without knowing why. And she opens her eyes and takes her shoe off. God, this is good. And we try this again. Go back under, sleep. So back she goes. When you open your eyes, you'll turn the clock round on the mantelpiece. So she opens her eyes and straight away runs across to the mantelpiece, turns the clock round. This sort of stuff you've seen. Fantastic. We're happy to try this all night now. We hypnotize her, and it's okay. When you open your eyes, as soon as you open your eyes, you'll have this uncontrollable urge to... And I looked at Melanie, and Charles looked at Melanie, and Charles looked at me, and I looked at him, and the thought is going through both our minds. And we didn't say anything. We just looked at each other and went, no. But that's how it started. That was my introduction to hypnosis, and for the rest of that summer, I spent the time persuading anybody I could to sit still and be hypnotized, as I saw, and varying degrees of success. Come autumn, I got some friends of mine had organized a lecture. There was a guest lecturer coming along to do a huge thing, lots of big crowd, very prestigious thing. Eric Lathwaite giving his gyroscope lecture, for any engineers who remember him. And fantastic, big crowd, lecture theatre packed out. Lathwaite phones up, can't do it. I've got flu. shit, what do we do? We've got to have a lecture. We've got the people all coming. It's Martin, you're the entertainer. Get out there. Do a lecture. Anything. Anything that's fun. Anything that will hold a crowd for a couple. Hypnotism. This thing you've been doing all summer. Get out there. Do a lecture on hypnotism. Shit, okay. So with about a couple of hours preparation, I found a couple of people who I thought were reasonably good subjects. One of them, Palab Ghosh, who's now BBC science correspondent, he helped me put this together. But I was almost literally pushed out in front of this crowd and told, do this hypnosis talk. So I talked a little bit about the theory that I knew and a little bit about the practice and some of the things that had happened to me over the summer, and eventually took volunteers out from the audience. Did the bit, swinging pendulum, fantastic. Standing ovation at the end, please can you come back and do it again? Word spreads, more and more people start inviting me to do this, and that kind of eventually got me onto the stage where I could make it my day job, where I could go professional. So far, so good. So far, so boring. So far, so ordinary. But then strange doubts started to creep in. I was wondering, is this really how it works? What is actually going on in people's minds? Because, well, I was finding, I like to finish my show with a fairly standard stunt. I would say to people, when you open your eyes, water will taste like your favorite drink. And they'd open their eyes, and they'd be drinking, you know, alcohol, they'd be drinking gin, they'd be drinking whiskey, they'd be drinking beer. And people would often come up to me afterwards, and they'd say, all these people drinking all this whiskey, are they gonna get pissed? And I'd say, well, let's see, let's find out. And sometimes they would be absolutely roaring drunk and they'd be falling about, banging on the floor, like, you know, all the classic ideas of people being pissed. Sometimes, nothing. Sometimes they'd say, no, this is actually water you've told me, so I'm not gonna get drunk. But I found something very interesting. Either all of them would get drunk or none of them would get drunk. What's going on? Because this is weird. This means that they're picking up on suggestions, not just from what I'm telling them when they're hypnotized, not even picking up on things from me. They're picking up on things from their surroundings. They're doing what they think they ought to be doing, watching the rest. He's getting drunk, maybe I should be getting drunk. He's not getting drunk, I should not be getting drunk. So we thought about this, and I amended the suggestion. I thought, well, maybe we can change the suggestions without the trance. So I'd be doing a show maybe where afterwards it was important that they didn't get drunk. Perhaps they were driving home. It was that kind of show or whatever. And I'd forget to say, you know, you won't be drunk when you open their eyes. So they'd open their eyes. And I'd turn to the audience. After they were awake, they were all here happily drinking away on their whiskey and their gin. I would say to the audience as an aside, even though they think they're drinking whiskey, because it's water, it will have no effect. What happens? No effect, nothing, completely sober. So I thought, all right, we'll try it the other way. So at other shows, I would say, as an aside to the audience, even though they're only drinking water, they're gonna get really drunk because they believe it's whiskey. What happens? They're all completely pissed. And this is something I'm saying to them where they're not hypnotized, they're not in trance. I'm not even saying it to them. They're just acting on what they think they are supposed to do. And it was little things like that that led me to believe that this hypnosis, the idea of telling them what to do while they are hypnotized, really doesn't have anything to do with how they're affecting their. They're, in a sense, playing the role they are expected to play. So I developed this idea of what I call hypnotism without hypnosis. People had suggested to me that there was no such thing as hypnosis, that it was just this idea of social compliance, which Professor Kirsch was explaining in detail in the first lecture this morning. I latched onto this and eventually got the urge to try this myself in my show. And I said to people, look, okay, we're gonna get people out here and I'm not going to hypnotize. There will be no trance. There is gonna be no altered state of mind. We're gonna do hypnotism without hypnosis. that's the title I gave it. It's James's name of Hypnotism Without Trance is probably more accurate, but I think it's a little bit less catchy. I've stuck with what I got, and we've each got our own website with that name, so we can't change it now. I take people out, and what I do in my show is I say at the start, I am not going to hypnotize you. This is hypnotism without hypnosis. I don't believe in any kind of altered state. I don't believe in any kind of trance. When you're out here, you'll respond for reasons of social pressure. Peer pressure, suggestion, obedience. I'm going to come onto that a little bit more later. But those are the three ingredients that we're using. People want to do what their friends do. There's a huge amount of suggestion in it, and people obey. Socially, it's very hard not to obey. John Chase earlier, he said, everybody, stand up. What happened? You all stood up. Was that hypnosis? Well, no, but you're doing what you're told. Same way, I've got people out here. I say, stand up, and they all stand up. Sit down, they all sit down again. And they're starting to do these sorts of things. Other people watching think, wow, he's got this mysterious kind of influence over them. We're doing the tricks of suggestion. So I'm explaining to them right at the beginning, there is no trance, there is no altered state, there is nothing, you know you could resist if you wanted. The way this works is you won't want to resist. And then I do essentially a classic hypnotist show, except there is no induction. I start out normally with the hand clasp, and you know, we find some suggestible people who can't get their hands apart. Then I will get one or two people out and do waking hypnosis, if that's the term you want to use. You can't speak, you've forgotten your name, and with a couple of good subjects, and they usually are in a crowd, we can get that working. Then I work with a whole bunch of them, and I just do a hypnosis show. The only thing different, there is no induction. Nothing to put them in a trance, nothing like that. I just say, I want you to do this. When you hear the magic music, you'll believe you're in orchestra. I want you to play an imaginary violin, and the way they all go, playing an imaginary violin, you'll scratch your face when you feel the itch. All the standard stuff, right through to hallucination, the whole works. Hypnotism without hypnosis. That is the basis of my show, and that is kind of how it works. But talking about this, so many people disagree. I mean, people out there who, when I've started talking about my attitude to hypnosis, my line on hypnosis, when I'm talking about it, particularly with therapists, with a lot of people, I found there are so many different viewpoints. Trance state, non-trance, state hypnotism, non-state hypnotism, all the various viewpoints, which I'm going to come on to in detail later. But it brings me on to the main thing that I want to talk about, that I feel that a lot of people here and in the hypnosis world generally do kind of defend their own little corner. They say, I do hypnosis, I know it works because I do it this way. And other people say, no, I know it works because I do it this way. And we're all kind of defending our own corner and putting our own point of view. I want to talk about the whole concept of hypnosis, whatever that is. And let's start out by looking at why there are still so many views about what hypnosis is. Even after 250 years, people still aren't quite sure what's going on. So, let's look at the history and historical reasons as to why there's still the confusion, particularly confusion between the therapists and the stage hypnotists. We start out, as you probably know, with Mesmer, the father of modern hypnotism. He was a rough contemporary of Mozart, he lived in Vienna, lived in the same sort of place, had this weird idea that illness was caused by animal magnetism, which flew through our bodies, and if it was out of kilter with the distant planets, we got sick. Mesmer produces this weird idea where people sit in a bath full of iron filings, and he's a great showman. He liked to swirl a big purple cape around as he walked up and down. He had an enormous rod, and he'd reach out and, thank you, that he'd, you get stuck for a word, don't you? He had a big staff he'd reach out and touch people with and get people to work themselves up into a huge emotional frenzy. Very primitive means of hypnosis. But, you know, at least hypnosis was now starting to be taken a little bit seriously by scientific communities. It had been taken away from the religious types and was started to become in the hands of doctors and scientists. James Braid, father of modern hypnosis, gave us the word in the 1840s. Now, Braid decides that he's going to investigate hypnosis. He got interested in hypnosis when he saw a stage hypnotist work, a guy called LaFontaine. And Braid watched LaFontaine do a stage show, devoted the rest of his life to studying hypnosis. Braid it was who had this this obsession with gaze and staring. Gaze, G-A-Z-E. He didn't care about people's sexual orientation. But he had this idea of fixing the gaze on something, and he got people to watch at a bright light, and he felt that this was necessary to put people into a trance. He got this idea of trance, he did a lot of investigation, he pioneered anesthetics and hypnosis as anesthetic, he pioneered a lot of the basic ideas. Baton was taken over by the Abbé de Faria, who realized that really it was just suggestion. De Faria, and there was the Nancy school, a guy called Hippolyte Bernheim, who worked in Nancy, who also did a lot of investigation and putting hypnosis and sort of starting to set forward the modern idea, no trance, purely hypnosis, purely suggestion. We move on through Couet and Freud and all the modern, through to Hilgard and all the people we know about, Milton Erickson, until eventually everybody knows there is no trance, there is no sleep, there is no altered state of mind. Hypnosis works purely through suggestion and social compliance. Well, no, that's how it should have happened. The only problem comes from way back is we get the problems with the stage hypnotists. Because there's this guy, LaFontaine, who Braid had seen do his show, and he's teaching stage hypnotists. Stage hypnotists are influencing the public. That's what the public see. They don't see the way hypnosis is being done in research. The public don't see much about what's going on in Nancy and Bernheim's work. What they see are guys going out doing flamboyant stage shows. This is an age where theater was really getting entangled into science. There was a huge vogue in that stage for etheromaniac parties. Ether had just been discovered as an anesthetic. And it was a fantastic, I mean, this could almost have gone the same way that hypnosis did. There were people doing etheromaniac shows, and they would take people out of the audience, sit them all out here on stage, and say, watch, we're going to anesthetize people. They'd take ether, hold it under their noses, and everybody would collapse on the floor. And then they'd cut them and show they didn't feel pain, and then they'd waft things, and the audience would laugh and clap and thought this was the most fantastic entertainment going. They loved it. And that is the public's view of hypnosis. The whole idea of mysterious trance states, of swinging the watch. And that has been maintained. And to some extent, that's what the public expect. And that's our problem when we try and hypnotize people. Because we've got people out there, and you say, well, what is hypnosis? What happened? Oh, I know about hypnosis. You put people in a trance, you black out. They've seen it happen on stage shows. They've seen McKenna do this, where he gets people out and loads of people on stage, and they play dreamy music and they flash lights, and they still do this. We've got this problem, but people still think hypnosis works that way. The other problem, hypnosis has been kind of hijacked, and the theatrics and the infiltration of public belief. It's important for the success of a stage hypnotist that you can see that people are hypnotized. You know, if a stage hypnotist does a show and the audience it was good, but I don't think they were really hypnotized, nobody's going to come back. You've got to give this impression that you have this power, and that's what's in the public's conscious. The next problem, people believe without questioning. We tend to believe without questioning. Back in medieval times, if you were a farmer and you wanted to make sure that your crops were fertile, you sprinkled blood on the field at the time of a full moon. Everybody did this. Why? Because everybody did this. You didn't dare not do it because your crops might fail. We have to just carry on doing stuff, unquestioning. We've always done it this way. It's what everybody does. There's doctors treating people for anemia used to use bloodletting. You know, you cut people, get some blood out. They've got it, they're anemic. Right, let's take some blood out. Why do you do that? We always do it that way. I feel we're so much stuck in the same way with hypnosis. We're scared of changing what we do. We know what we're... It's like the old joke about the man who pours a pot of treacle over his doorpost every morning, and people say, why do you do that? And he says, well, it's to keep the wild kangaroos away. And they say, wild kangaroos? There aren't any wild kangaroos. You see, it works! You know, we are like that. Very often, we don't like to change what we do because we know it works. On stage, I get a bunch of people out here. I've given you the examples that I start with. I start with the hand clasp test. The first thing I nearly always do is get them playing an imaginary orchestra. I don't like to change that. It's what I've always done. We're scared of changing. And I think to a certain extent, with therapy as well. You've done what you know works. You've only got one client there at a time. You can't experiment a bit differently. You know, if you're a chemist or something, you do an experiment, and you've got this experiment that you always do, and you do it with ascorbic acid, and you've always used ascorbic acid, you can say, well, let's try it with citric acid instead and see what happens. Doesn't work, who cares? You go back to ascorbic acid. We're doing it, I got this one show, it's got to work, otherwise I fall flat on my face. Therapists out there, you've got one client. If you change what you do, it doesn't work, big problem. Therapist's gonna get cross, go away, bad publicity, doesn't work, all falls over. We like to do, we stick with what we know works, and we believe it without questioning. And there's also this matter of simply pragmatism. It works, who cares why it works? This is a feature of NLP, I think. They almost boast about this. Hey, you don't need to know about this. Who cares why it works? Doesn't matter, you know, we're proud of the fact we don't understand. It works, that's all we need. And this whole idea of pragmatism and refusing to change it, and because of what the public expect, because we think it's what the public expect, we don't dare change it. Jonathan was saying in the last talk, he still does a trance induction. He knows it's not necessary. We all stage hypnotists know that it isn't really necessary. I think we all do. He still does it. It's what's expected. So I'm not going to change what I do. Not changing what I do is almost justifiable because you know it works up to a point, but that leads on to not changing what we believe. We're not going to change what we do. Fair enough. We know it works. We're happy. We're a bit scared. But that means we get entrenched in our own belief. We think, yes, I believe it works this way. We don't like to change that. We also have the need to maintain authority, both with our clients and with our audiences. If you go out and you start saying, well, I've had this idea, I've been reading these books, and I'm not sure that it works the way I always thought it did. Maybe it'll work this way if I tried it. You lose authority. For a therapist, it's important. For a stage hypnotist, it's massively important. You've got to give the impression that you know what you're doing. You've got to get out there, you've got to say to people, look, it works like this. I know, I'm experienced. It's the authority which more than anything else actually gets people to respond to the suggestions you're giving them. There's the need to maintain authority with both clients and audiences, and there's the need to make money too. Again, we find that if we say things, like Jonathan was touching on this point in his talk too, we say things which we know may not be true because it's what people want, that's how we're gonna get our money. What we say is what affects the size of our audience. The size of our audience affects how much we get paid. The number of references we get from clients affects. You know, we've got to broaden our client base. And we do that, again, by sticking to what we know, by giving people what they expect. Stage hypnotists and, to some extent, therapists will say things which are illogical, which may be untrue, because that is what people want, and they go away saying, yes, I feel I was hypnotized, I felt that was a real hypnotist, he did the right things. So that's why we've got all this kind of confusion amongst us. So let's look now at what hypnosis really is and do a little bit towards sorting it out. I don't have any great answers, But I do want to actually put some theory and some ideas together and to give you some things to talk about and to suggest. But the first thing is, do we need to sort it out? Does it matter? If I think hypnosis works like this, you think hypnosis works like that, you're getting success over here, I'm getting success over here, does it matter? Do we need to understand? Do we need to know what the mechanism is? And there are people who say no. I say yes, it is massively important for several reasons. Firstly, scientific integrity. We've got to understand what's going on, otherwise we're kind of deceiving ourselves. Just to go through life saying, well, we think it works like this because it works, we tell people like that and it makes them happy. No, there's no integrity there. We've got to do what we believe. It. There's some kind of duty on us, I think, to actually investigate what is real and how the thing really works. It's very hard for us to do that. It's very hard to actually work out what's going on, particularly when we are either stage hypnotists or therapists. I was really pleased to hear the first talk this morning, Professor Kirsch, explaining the way it has been actually, he's actually been testing it in the laboratory and some of the experiments which have been done. Fantastic. Yes, it is terribly important for our scientific integrity. Not necessarily the techniques we use. You know, we don't need to agree on what techniques we should do it, what the best way is, whether it's better to say, oh, your hand is rising on its own, or allow your hand to rise, or you feel there's a hand rise. As long as we agree on the mechanism, what is happening psychologically. So, and the other thing that I mentioned at this stage is, again, something which John Chase refers to as lies to children. It is confused by the fact that sometimes we do have to bend the truth when we're talking to the subjects. We're telling people things which, well, we don't completely believe they're true, but if you believe it, then it's going to work a hell of a lot better, and we know that. And my aim is to put on an entertaining show. Your aim is to cure people of their problems, to help people. Maybe the best way to do this is to bend the truth slightly when we're talking to our clients, when we're talking to our audiences, but not when we're talking to each other. When we're here with ourselves, it's so important to actually find out what's really going on. So what divergence of views are there? Well, there are people who say hypnosis is a trance. It is an altered state. We've got people like John Grazelier, who I think works here, doesn't he, at King's? Somebody? No, yeah? Nobody knows. Okay. But he's one of these people who wires people up, does all the brain scans, and says, look, when people are in a trance, you can see they're in a trance because the brain scan works differently. You've got people at the other end of the scale. You've got people like Graham Wagstaff in Liverpool. You've got people like Spanos and Chaves doing research. And they say, there is no such thing as hypnosis. It really, you know, it's just entirely social compliance. It's people doing a kind of line which I lean to myself. There's a broad spread of people even here amongst the people we've got. A line Andrew Newton uses a lot, which you've seen a lot of people say, and that's you're driving along in a car, you drive for 20 miles, and at the end of 20 miles, you've got no recollection of what you do. That's hypnosis. We all go into hypnosis two or three times a day. Well, is that true? Is that the same hypnosis? Is that the same hypnosis that Jonathan Chase means when he says, if people aren't hallucinating, then you haven't got hypnosis? I mean, how can it be? We've got to sort out what we're talking about. We've got to find out exactly what people are, you know. Some people say there's hypnosis even when there's patently nothing there. You know, I've done it myself when I do a really bad show and you've just got people doing what I tell them because I'm telling them to do it. You know, we have to kind of maintain the fiction that there's hypnosis. I suspect, although my experience of therapy is nil, I suspect there are some therapists who do the same. And they say, just because you didn't feel you were hypnotized doesn't mean you weren't. It's there. It's in your mind. On the other hand, again, sort of somewhere on the middle course, we've got Anthony who says people are scared of asking for hypnotic phenomena in the consulting room because they're afraid they won't get it. Ask for it. You will get it if they are properly hypnotized. You will get these hypnotic phenomena. Huge range of views. So, what's going on? Is there such a thing as hypnosis at all? Well, my broad, oversimplified view is to say, no, not in any way that's commonly perceived. I do this show called Hypnotism Without Hypnosis. At the end, I make a point of saying to everybody, were you hypnotized in the classical sense? And they say no. Did you go into a trance? No. Did you black out, lose consciousness, altered state? No. Could you have resisted if you wanted? Yes. So why didn't you? Don't know. Bit weird, but I didn't. This whole idea of social compliance, suggestion, peer pressure, and obedience. There was, we still sometimes cling to this whole idea of hypnotism because it's out there, because it's in the public consciousness. There was, are you familiar with the idea of N-rays, which followed? Anybody heard of N-rays? No. Shortly after Röntgen discovered X-rays, a guy in Nancy again, a guy called Blondlow, discovered N-rays. And he found this fantastic machine which emitted N-rays. And there were about 50, 60 papers published on the properties of N-rays, which were emitted by certain substances, various metals, unless you swab them with ether, dead wood, but not live wood, living flesh, living organisms. They all sent out N-rays. And there were papers published, how you could refract them, calculating the refractive index of N-rays, working out what subjects they would pass through, how thick the object needed to be to stop the N-rays. Big school of thought, and then people, suddenly somebody came along and said, just a minute, the emperor has no clothes, let's look at this. Started looking at it very seriously, consider the possibility, there weren't such things, nothing there. I think a lot of us have to consider the possibility there is no such thing as hypnosis. Whether we tell our clients this, I don't know, it was a big step for me when I started to say to people on stage, there is no such thing as hypnosis. Yet it still works. It still has exactly the same effect, even though I'm telling them it's just social compliance. But what about things like hallucination? People hallucinate? Well, do they? How do you know? How could you tell someone is hallucinating? Well, they say they were. I say to someone at the end of my show, there's an elephant. And people say, oh my God, an elephant. How do you know they're seeing an elephant? If you wire them up so that you can tell what's going through the visual cortex, there's nothing there impinging on the retina. There's nothing, no signal firing to say there's an elephant there. You know? Anthony earlier was saying 70% of the people he asks afterwards, you know, they hallucinate floating a cup in the air. And you ask them, 70% of them say, well, no, I couldn't actually see it, but it was sort of, I knew it was there, and it was sort of a bit weird. What's going on? Do they really? And then you turn to the other 30%. Well, what are they seeing? Because I found this thing in my show. There are people who you afterwards, they say, well, I couldn't see an elephant, but I knew I had to behave as if there was one there. And then you get the others who say, I don't know what the hell you're talking about. I could see an elephant. But are they telling the truth? How do we know? Maybe this is just the social compliance which extends along to really maintaining this fiction, to convincing themselves that they could see an elephant. We have no way of knowing what someone else's social, what someone else's subjective perception is of what's going on out there. We don't know. And yet, can suggestion really account for the anesthesia, people undergoing, you know, serious operations, amputations, open limb operations, you know, people undergoing vasectomy with hypnosis as the only anesthetic. I'm not saying that there is no such thing as hypnosis, although I do say it to my audiences for dramatic effect, but I am saying, oh, what is going on there? So, well, what is going on? And I think that, is it one phenomenon or several? Well, my basic idea is that it's a whole complicated cocktail of different ideas. I think it is very different ideas working on different people. It is this huge cocktail of ideas when I'm working on people. Some people, it's just obedience. They're out here, they're not quite sure what to do. I say, play an imaginary violin. And they go, all right. And they start doing this. You know, Jonathan says, everybody stand up. You all stand up. And with some people, obedience is the big part. With some people, it's peer pressure, doing what their friends do. They see everybody else doing it, they think, oh, I better do it as well. I don't want to be the only one. You know, you do the falling back test. Everybody falls back. You know, the one who sat there going, oh, it didn't work on me. You fall back. There's peer pressure. There's suggestion. We all know how suggestion works. We all know that if I talk about saliva, you all start to salivate. I talk about the way spit builds up in your mouth, and you can feel the saliva starting to build in your mouth, and you know it's there in your mouth, around your teeth and your tongue, and you're trying not to swallow because you know that's what I'm trying to make you do. But the more I talk about saliva, the harder it is not to think about saliva. But I'm carrying on talking about it, and you're trying not to swallow, and I can see you all out there now going, ah. There's suggestion, there's peer pressure, there's obedience, there's outright fear on stage. Some hypnotists are really aggressive, and they take, you know, people know, he's made a dickhead out of him, he's made him look a complete prat. If I don't do what he says, maybe he's going to start turning on me. And they just go along with this. In therapy, we've got the placebo effect, which we heard so much about this morning. Is that what it is? Well, I think it's all these things. Different responses, even from the same hypnotist in the same session. Very hard to argue, but, you know, I think it is just a complete mishmash of different things which produce this huge overall thing which we've come to label hypnosis, and it embraces a vast amount of stuff. Working maybe on the same person in different ways at different times. Darren Brown tells of people who he's got along, and they've been excellent subjects when he's hypnotized them in his living room. Later on, he gets them on stage and does it, and it appears exactly as though it's working wonderfully, and afterwards they say, funny, it didn't work while I was on stage. I was just doing it because you told me to. Or sometimes it works the other way around. They'll say, you know, when I was in your living room, I was just doing it because I felt it ought to go. But when I was out there on stage, my God, I actually saw the elephant. It is a huge mix-up. It's a really complicated idea. Again, to borrow an analogy from Darren, well, his idea, he equates the term hypnosis to the term magic in the sense of conjuring. How is it done? How do you do magic? I want to learn to do magic. Well, you know, some people use sleight of hand. Some people use trick boxes. Some people use, so help me, confederates. Some people use a lot of psychology. Some people use trick packs of cards. And by combining these things in lots and lots of different ways, we can create the illusion that we do magic on stage. The audience doesn't care what's going on. You know, they might like to puzzle a bit about what's going on, but as far as they're concerned, it's all embraced in the one term. It's magic. Fantastic. He does magic. But if you go along and you say, I want to do magic, well, what do you mean magic? You know, there's no one secret. There is no one thing which is magic. Maybe hypnosis is the same thing. Maybe some people are using obedience, some people are using peer pressure, some people are tapping into the subconscious in some way. And it is all embraced in this huge thing called hypnosis. So, what are we doing about this? Well, this is what I think we need to do. Controlled testing. Very, very hard, particularly for the likes of you and me. You're doing a lot of you are doing it on for clients in the consulting room. You can't do a controlled test because the guy's come to you, he's paid money to give up smoking, to lose weight, whatever it is. I'm out there on stage, I've been paid to do a show. I can't say, well, let's do it this way, and then let's do it that way, and see if it doesn't work over there and it does work over there. Luckily, there are people like Professor Kirsch who do have the resources and the opportunity to do it under controlled conditions. We've got to learn from them. We've got to, I think, really follow his work and invite people like him to come and talk at things like this. I was just so pleased to hear his opening talk this morning. We need to be honest in what we do. We need to admit when there are things that we don't know, not necessarily to clients, not necessarily to audiences on stage. You can't say, well, I don't know really how hypnosis works, but we're going to give it a go, we'll see what happens. But I think it is important to tell each other, to say, I think it might work like this, or have you tried this? Suggesting ideas to one another. Clear thinking. We've got to compare what we do with what others do, and not just take the line of our teachers or other people with authority. We don't just believe what other people say. I think there's a big tendency when people get up and say things, particularly charismatic people, to believe what they say because they're there, they're huge, they're charismatic, they're a big name. I mean, Jonathan was out, has he gone? Jonathan was on stage earlier. He says, I get 100% success with all my clients. I don't believe that, do you? I don't know. I think we need to be very careful about the way we use language. When people say, we all go into hypnosis several times a day. When people say, it's not really hypnosis unless you're hallucinating, which he does say in his book. Again, you know, does this make kind of a mockery of the fact that two people in the same room can say both those sentences? Doesn't this make a mockery of what we're using the word hypnosis to mean? I think we have to be very careful about distorting language. What we mean by we say induction. You can't say, well, I do an induction, but I mean this by it. Manipulating doesn't really mean this, it means that. No, you've got to stick to the meanings of words. You can't just distort the meanings of words to make things say what you want. It may be necessary to mislead the subjects, as I've said. It's ethically dubious, but it may be necessary for me to tell lies to the people on stage. Jonathan's line of lies to children. It may be necessary, again, I think ethically suspect for hypnotherapists to tell clients things which aren't necessarily straight, but ethically not happy. Misleading other hypnotists and other interested parties, I think now we're moving away from ethically dubious. We're starting to get a little bit arrogant and a little bit, you know, a little bit stupid. And misleading ourselves, if we're really believing what we say, that's just stupid. So when we start discussing hypnosis amongst ourselves, please let's try and give a little bit of thought. Let's think about what we're doing. Let's think about what we're saying when we're explaining it to each other. Let's not say too much without evidence. People don't say things on stage so much, but a lot of the books I read, people just say things and they come out with stuff, you know, plonk, we only use 10% of our mind. And they're like, well, where's your evidence? What do you mean by that, Mr. McKenna? You know, you may only using 10% of your mind, I'm using 100% of mine, I know that. Don't say these things without evidence. And again, when you're writing stuff up, reference it. Don't just say, scientists have shown this. It was done by a group of scientists in America. No, I want to see the references when you're writing stuff up in books, in textbooks, and so on. Because that is the only way that we're only going to start really understanding what hypnosis is. And that is the way I think we can advance what we're doing, find better ways of using it as entertainment on stage, if you will, and finding better ways and more effective ways of using it as hypnotherapists. That's pretty much all I need to say. I'm sure it isn't at all what you thought I was going to be talking about. I'm sorry if it's been a little less entertaining than what you were expecting, but that's all. I've got about 5 minutes left. Fire some questions at me, either on that or about my actual work that I do when I do work as a hypnotist. Yeah, guy at the back.
Okay, it's okay to say about scientific questioning of hypnosis and research. I've actually been doing some work at St. Mary's University, where part of the project was we did a research project on hypnosis. And in any real clinical scientific test, I'm sure Professor Kirsch will bear me out on this, for something to be accepted as an absolute, it has to be repeatable. It has to be blind tested and repeatable. And because of the nature of hypnosis, I could read a script and I could do some work with somebody. Joe could read the same script, get completely different. I think it's the same words, but it's different because his attitude would be different to my attitude. You're never going to get clinical scientific proof because everyone works differently, every client's different, that your attitude that you take into that research is completely different.
I'm not saying it's easy. I'm not saying that there's anything simple you can do. And I said in the talk that for a hypnotherapist who has clients there, you know, it's very hard to design an experiment because you're being paid by the client, you're being paid for results. For me on stage, I think it's not. But I mean, any kind of experiment in psychology, you can say, well, it's different people out there doing different things. You know, they're all going to respond to different ways. Any psychology experiment has this variable. You've got to design the experiment. You've got to do the research very, very carefully. You know, I mean, otherwise you might as well dismiss all of psychology by saying, well, we're working on different people. You can't do an experiment in psychology.
Thank you very much. Found that very interesting. But is this really what you're doing? Is it really hypnosis without hypnosis? Or is that just an assumption that for it to be hypnosis, there must be an induction? Or are you in fact doing an induction, but you're just not doing what we classically recognize as an induction?
That's exactly the point, is that we mustn't be playing with words here. It's, you know, I use the term hypnotism without hypnosis. I mean, hypnotism, hypnosis, they're the same thing. It's a catchpenny title. It's something that sounds good when I can stick it on my website. But I'm doing a classical hypnosis show, essentially, except I explain to the audience at the start, there is no trance, and I'm not going to do an induction in the sense that you will be expecting one. I will not be swinging a watch. I will not telling you to go to sleep. I'm not going to spend any time at all doing anything like that. All I'm telling you to do is just close your eyes. And the only reason I do that is so that the audience won't pull silly faces and make them laugh. You know, it's just an extension of, I mean, the hand clasp thing. Is that hypnosis? Are they hypnotized when I say to people, you can't unclasp your hands, and they're standing there like that? Is that hypnosis? You say so? Okay. Well, not of course it is. I mean, it depends what we're using the word hypnosis to mean. And this isn't a question of psychology. This is a question of semantics. Well, fine, as long as we admit that, and as long as we know it, and as long as we admit it to our audiences. I think the public, you get people up on stage, and they go to McKenna's show, and McKenna says he got people's hands stuck together to see who the ones were he could hypnotize. And then the ones who got their hands stuck together, those were the ones he chose to hypnotize. So they're using the word hypnosis in a different way. So it is very much a semantic point.
Yeah, but that is just as much lying to the audience when he says that he's looking for people he can hypnotize, as if somebody's saying that he's not going to hypnotize them, and then does it.
Well, I don't think it's lying. I just think it's a question of how we define.
Or is it just a vocabulary question once again?
It's a semantic one. It's what do we mean by hypnosis?
Do we have an answer?
I don't care. I don't care what we mean by hypnosis. I don't care whether this is hypnosis or whether this is hypnosis or this is hypnosis. I think we are really stretching a point. If I say everybody stand up and you all stand up and I say that's hypnosis. I think we're stretching a point if we say the only way you can hypnotize people is if they hallucinate. If they're not hallucinating, then it's not hypnosis. I think that's, you know, we then got the word hypnosis really distorted and really tied in knots. But I think it's important that in any discussion we do know what we're talking about. I should thank you for your attention, and we'll carry on this discussion, I'm sure, later on. Thank you. Thank you.